ॐ ज्ञानतिमिरन्धस्य ज्ञानञ्जनाशलाकाय चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः.
Well, Wisher left the world. In fact, there's a section there that says his father had forgotten about death, but death didn't forget about him. There were 9 siblings, and they didn't care so much for Judd Barrett because they just thought he was a useless animal-like a sibling, so they would feed him whatever was left over at the bottom of the pot. You know, sometimes if you burn something, Keisha, they burn something, and then it's at the bottom and they scrape it off. Usually, like, you throw it away or give it to the fish, but they would give that to Judd Barrett. Do you think he liked it?
No, but
he liked it. He ate it like it was nectar. He didn't discriminate palatable or unpalatable. He considered whatever was fine, because he had completely detached himself from the idea that I'm the body and there's something for me in the material world. And this is something that's also in the Bhagavad Gita. We read on the way over here also in the 18th chapter of the Gita, and it matches up very nicely where Krishna talks about how to come to the Brahma-Bhuta platform, one has to be indifferent to the various changes of the material world, the ups and downs, that something's pleasurable, unpleasurable, it's all the same, ultimately, because it's the material world. And earlier, Rishabhdev says, leading up to Bharat, when he was instructing his 100 sons, one of whom was Bharat Maharaj, he said that it's really a bad idea that you've come to the material world. Don't make it worse. Don't get more entangled. You came here ill-advisedly, and now that you're here, try to get out of it. Do everything possible to get out of it. Don't think I'll do halfway this, halfway that. There's nothing in the material world. We only do our duty here because it's from momentum. Just as Mahaprabhu is mentioned when he was doing his devotional service, he would go through the other activities in his life, the required activities, as if mechanically. He would just do them. But the main purpose is to think about Krishna. So these stories are very inspiring. And finally, we just read on the way here about how the mind is the center of all the senses. And if you can think of Krishna, you train your mind to think of Krishna by doing service. You do some service, right? Yeah. And by chanting. The other night, I came to the temple a little early, and I saw the devotees. There were a few of them in the temple room, and they were sitting before the deities, and they were just chanting. I was thinking, this is sublime. And I sat behind them, and I was just relishing that they were sitting there and they were just repeating the Lord's names. And that's all you have to do. You just do it every day. And you do have to do it every day. That's another thing I was thinking about. When you get initiated, you have to do this every day. You can't say, I'll stop for a week or even for a day. You can't do that. And why? Think of what happened to Bharat Maharaj. He was so advanced, and Prabhupada says this again and again, he was so advanced, but he drifted away, and he lost everything. And don't do that. Take advantage. You're lucky. You have the opportunity. Everything's in place. Just take advantage of it. And even if you're not doing it in a remarkable way, a way in which people are looking and saying, oh, what a great devotee. If you're just quiet and that's the way you are, and you're methodical, and you just do the what's required to stay in touch with Krishna every day. Just check it off your list. I did my rounds. I read something from Bhagavad Gita. I'm being a good self-controlled person, taking prasadam. And just run out your life like that. You'll attain something that is unimaginable. That's why you're lucky. And you're lucky also, even in the scope of ISKCON, to have a tight-knit group. Not everybody has that. There are temple communities, there are parts of ISKCON's a wide organization, so there's so many different parts to it. But you have a family here, and it's a growing family, and it's a loving family. It's a family where you can see that the devotees are all making advancement. And when you find yourself in the material world, it said, if you find yourself in a hole, stop digging. But in the spiritual world, when you find yourself in a spiritual family, just keep giving and become one with that. That's meaning give yourself to it and go back to Godhead in this lifetime. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. How's everybody? What else are you going to say? Right? After I said how lucky you are. Terrible, right? What have you been up to, Samriddhi? What? What? You're finishing which Bhagavatam? Third canto. We just read third canto when we were in Govardhan. Did you like it? I like five. What? Oh, you knew about that, eh? But we picked the third canto because it has a little bit of everything. I mean, Prabhupada said you could pick anywhere, and he said it'll be sweet. But third canto starts off with Uddhava remembering Vrindavan, all the pastimes of Krishna. He summarizes all of them, and then it gets into some very detailed philosophy, and there's incarnations of the Lord who appear. But once we had finished the third canto, we just kept going. And then it became an intense race to see if we could finish. So in the last 3 days, we read for 7 hours. And nobody got tired. No one said, I want to quit. They were leaning in even more. You could see the Bhagavatam never gets old. And if someone shows up to hear, and you increase the hearing, then they just become more satisfied. It's a good test. The material world, I mean, if it's a good movie, you can only really watch it once, or maybe twice. I don't know. But Bhagavatam, you can read it 1,000 times. Srila Bhaktisiddhanta said, read Prahlad, the whole story of Prahlad, and Dhruva Maharaj. He told his disciples, read it 100 times each. And Mahaprabhu used to hear from Gadadhar Pandit. Gadadhar Pandit would read to Mahaprabhu, and especially Mahaprabhu liked to hear those two sections, Dhruva Maharaj and Prahlad Maharaj. What's that?
Prahlad Maharaj and
Dhruva. Dhruva Maharaj. Both 5-year-old children. And also it said in the Brihat Bhagavatamrita that sometimes the gopis, when they hear about Dhruva and Prahlad, they cry because they're thinking, these 5-year-old boys, and they were pure devotees, and they went through so much, and they tolerated everything. So we're lucky to have the Bhagavatam, right? You're studying Bhagavatam. Yeah? Krishna.
We are reading Bhagavatam third canto.
You're reading Bhagavatam third canto?
Yeah.
Are you two reading together sometimes? You just happen to be on the same canto?
Yeah.
And what about you?
I think she doesn't read.
Does it read? Does she like to listen? Likes to chant?
She likes to chant, yeah.
She likes to chant.
She
She's a good chanter. Do you chant kirtan or do you like to chant japa or both? She's a little shy right now.
She chants japa.
She does very good artwork also.
And artwork. We're hearing good things about you. Maybe that's why. She's very humble.
She made this vase today for
She made the vase?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. I see some talent emerging here. This devotional talent. Well, Diana, how's everybody in New York? The Sankirtan's going on really well there, I hear. Nice. Thanks for coming down. We had a really nice ride from the airport. She had good questions. So it never has to stop, actually, on the you can be anywhere and you can keep the vibration going, and when you're connected to Krishna, we were reading on the way back that when your mind is engaged in sense gratification, it's like a ghee lamp that is not set up properly, and it starts putting out black smoke, just this black smoke everywhere. But when the ghee lamp is filled up with ghee and the wick is perfectly in the middle, then it's nice, clear burning, nice bright light. So this is Jud Bard, he was telling Maharaj Rahugana, when the mind is trained to think of Krishna, it becomes very bright. Speaking of bright, look who just walked in. Oh, thank you very much. This is beautiful. Got a butterfly and a heart. That's nice. So what other news? Well, I mean, Lord Karbhajan Muni said that a lot of great souls will be born into the Krishna consciousness movement. Mm-hmm. And I'm seeing kids at ISV and all over the world and just observing them growing up. And it's very special to be born into devotional families, in Lord Chaitanya's movement and so forth. So there's one young kid, his name's Vrindavan, he's 11 now?
10.
He's 10? But when he was a baby, he always wanted to pick up the madonga. He's like, no, don't pick up the madonga, you'll break it. He'd look at me like, you don't know who you're talking to. I know madonga. By the time he was 2, you know, he was reaching out, and then he just became, kind of a world-class madonga player. Mm. And these children are coming into the movement for a reason, so we can take inspiration. What else? You're all healthy? You taking care of yourselves? That's important too. We were talking on the way home about how Krishna says in the Gita, Yukta Hara Viharasya. He mentions that, to practice yoga, you have to sleep enough. He said, don't sleep too much and don't sleep too little. That means yukta, be balanced. And also he said, don't eat too much and don't eat too little.
Like, don't eat so much because you
don't
get fat.
Yeah, that's true. Probably mentioned it in several places in the Bhagavatam. He said that his spiritual master, Srila Bhakti Siddhanta, used to not like his disciples to get fat because they were thinking it slows things down. Of course, devotional service is transcendental to any situation. It's important to take care of yourselves also. You got to have a good diet and exercise. Right? From the Ayurveda?
Yes.
What are the news?
She finished Bhagavatam.
Bhagavatam?
Yeah.
Only once.
She
that's
also
all.
Finished last time.
Congratulations. How did you do it?
I for some time, for 5-6 months, I read for 41 pages
for 6 months. Wow. So, how did you arrange that?
I just took a vow last Kartik that I'll read more just for the Kartik, but then I keep on.
But you couldn't stop.
Yeah.
You were afflicted.
Yeah, she really made him comforting.
That's one nice thing about taking these vows during special periods, because you realize you have more potential than you thought. Sometimes when you stretch it out like that, then you don't come back in. You stay at that level and you'll know what you're capable of, right? Yeah. And you finished too?
Yeah.
How did you do it?
I read 20 pages generally, Bhagavatam every day, and on weekends I do a bit more. So.
Very good. That's the good use of a weekend. Read Bhagavatam. You were also?
No, he finished it.
You finished also? And also you? Very good.
Wow.
Yeah, of course, there's no end to it. Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya. We're always serving Bhagavatam. But what did you think of it? Any impressions?
It's so amazing. I would love to go back to it again. I'm reading Chaitanya Charitamrita right now, first book. I finished the first Adi, the second book of Adi.
And do you read the Bengali?
No.
Good, right?
I don't know how to read.
Oh, you don't know how to read Bengali?
No.
Oh. Well, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati said, one day people will learn Bengali just to read the Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, such an important book. And then Prabhupada just made it available to the whole world. It's amazing what he did. I was wondering what your impression of going through the whole Bhagavatam is. Any impression? Who did? But you finished also. So what were your impressions of reading the whole Bhagavatam?
Kind of froze on you when I started reading it.
Yeah.
It seemed more like a burden, but I kept on. I was doing just 10 pages a day.
Yeah.
But just after like 2 cantos or so, I started enjoying reading it.
Yeah.
And then it kind of just grows on you, and then you start seeing that there are very important verses, then I start noting them down and, you know, trying to memorize them. It becomes much and much more enjoyable as you move ahead.
Nice.
Yeah, I also realized the more pages you read, the more, you know, you get more realization and more rasa you get it. If you just read like 3 pages or 5 pages, next day you forget what did you read. But if you read more, you know, it stays.
Goes in there. We read one passage in the first canto where Prabhupada says that although the ear holes are very small, inside is as big as the sky.
Mm.
So you can go on hearing more and more.
Mm.
And it's true that if you do a little more, it's even like with chanting japa, sometimes somebody's chanting, of course it always depends on the quality, but somebody chants 1 round, 4 rounds, 6 rounds, and they can't get a taste. But sometimes when you're chanting 16 rounds, you get your taste at 15 and a half rounds. If you can ever get that taste where you think, oh, I don't want to stop, I wish I could keep going, that's a good sign. And a not so good sign is where I feel like, oh, I can't do this, I don't want to do it. But doing more helps. That's why the Padma Purana says, Nama Parada Yuktanam Nama Nyeva Harantyugam Avishrani Priyuktani Tanye Varta Karanicha. That even if you're chanting offensively, if you chant continuously and don't stop, then you can overcome your offenses. It's a good technique. Try to overflood the mind with more. Put more in. Like Prabhupada said, filling a glass of ink, you keep pouring in milk, and more you pour, and then after some time all the ink goes out, and you just get milk inside. So same thing. There's so many thoughts and nartas, distractions, but if you keep adding more Krishna consciousness, then the rest goes out. We just read recently an article by one of Prabhupada's godbrothers in which he was talking about the importance of responsibility in Krishna consciousness. Did any of you see that? Yeah, it was Prabhupada's godbrother, Bhakti Rakshak Sridhar Maharaj of Navadvip. He was a great scholar and wonderful devotee. He was saying how when you take responsibility in Krishna consciousness, you take something on your shoulders, on your head, and you have to think about it. How do I execute my duty? You're responsible. That helps keep you fixed. He said sometimes lust or greed will come to visit you, but they'll peep in and they'll see, oh, he's busy. I can't do anything. He's too busy. And then they'll leave. So he was talking about how this responsibility is really important, and Prabhupada mentions it too in the Bhagavatam, in that verse, Kriyasya Chacharanadavindaya, in the 10th canto, where it's just by manual labor, one also is able to fix the mind in Krishna consciousness. It means working for Krishna, doing some responsible work. And if you do that, then that helps to keep you steady also, the two things together. And that's the being part of a movement, Sankirtan movement, where we actually have a mission. We're not just sitting in the forest chanting, trying to do 192 rounds every day. Are we trying to do that any of you? Ever? Yeah, it's not possible in this age. So Prabhupada gave us lots of service to spread the Sankirtan movement along with a modicum of chanting, hearing and chanting that we can handle. If you do those two things together, it's a good balance, right? Are you all finding that? Because you're all working hard to spread the movement. You're working together as a team. Yes?
Yes. We had a very good summer this year. We did so many festivals, new festivals this year. Some were like, one on Virginia Beach was really amazing. Like, within 2 hours, all of our books were gone.
Wow.
We had very good festivals. So we went to Boston also this year. So
yeah.
Very pleasant news. Do you go on book distribution?
Jaina.
Huh?
Jaina.
Jaina? Jaina. What a nice name. Jaina? Do you go on book distribution? You can look up because I'm looking the other way. Jaina, do you go on book distribution sometimes?
Did you go to DC Express?
I think. Oh, that's Samriddhi. She knows. Samriddhi, does Jaina go on book distribution sometimes? She's good, right? Yeah? That's good. Jaina, you could come out this weekend? Can we go out together sometimes? I want to go out with you just for a little while. Okay? Somebody, is that a yes? That's very welcome news. I mean, that's, you're finding ways and means to distribute books. And people really need it. I was standing in the San Francisco airport because I had to do an extra check on my bag. And I was looking out into the airport and I saw a bookstore. It said books. And I was thinking, yeah, people still like books. They're really wild about them because human beings, they have the evolved consciousness to have a hunger for knowledge. You want all kinds of knowledge because it's a chit potency. It comes from Krishna, but the living entity has it. You notice everybody's trying to drink in some knowledge by looking at a book or a paper or something like that. But then I thought, all the books in that bookstore don't penetrate deeply enough to satisfy the soul. But with Bhagavad Gita, actually, sometimes it's so deep what we're distributing that sometimes it seems out of step with the rest of society. Sometimes if devotees aren't reading very carefully and practicing very carefully so that they're deeply appreciating what Krishna consciousness is, they start thinking, our books they're too esoteric, people can't understand them, or like we're out of step with the rest of society because the rest of society is talking about very superficial things. But the Bhagavatam comes right in and says, Dharma Projita Kaitavo, cut out all the junk. We're going right to the pure devotional service. And by Lord Chaitanya's mercy, if it's packaged through Lord Chaitanya's system of chanting, dancing, feasting, people can take it. It's a big festival. People like to take prasadam, they like to chant and dance. And then the philosophy becomes natural, it can go in. And then the books can actually satisfy them. And I've seen so many people, there's a devotee who joined our community a long time ago, but he was like a laborer, and his English, I don't know, English was first or second language, but then I just started noticing that he was reading Prabhupada's books all the time, because every time I'd meet him, he'd fix things and, do manual kind of labor, and then he'd always, while he was doing it, he'd be talking, yeah, I just read in the Bhagavatam, and he'd start talking about it, and I was like, this is suited for living entities. They need this kind of knowledge. Unless they get it, unless it's available to human society, it's a really cruel hoax. The whole society, the way it's going on, offering some kind of happiness and then retracting it before anybody actually gets it. Like the holidays, I was watching people coming in, oh, hi, sweetie, good to see you, and everything, and I was thinking, you know, it won't be satisfying. They'll go home for some dinner, Most people dread going home to see their family anyway, and you know, they try to dress up in a certain way to show themselves off, that like, this is who I am in the world now, you know, because it's a false identity that they're trying to portray. And there's no satisfaction, especially after Christmas, that, you know, big extravaganza, all advertised, and then they all go home and they feel quite unsatisfied. But we have something that can actually satisfy. Yeah, Kartavya. How are your studies going, sir? That's what I've heard. What are you studying?
Stuff.
That's what I thought. That used to be a thing when you come home from school, parents say, what did you learn today? Nothing. What did you do? Go to your room, close the door.
He's reading Bhagavatam to Maharaj.
Yeah. I know, he's a big reader and studier. You're on the Bhagavatam?
Fifth
canto, which part? Fifth canto, which part of the fifth canto? Like which section? What are you reading about?
The 23rd chapter.
Getting far along there. Like, yeah. About the universe?
Yeah.
Jambudvi? What do you make of it?
I like the stuff where like the project where it's saying, I also like the stuff where it's saying how the difference of the sun is like a rainfall and stuff.
Yeah. Interesting. Yeah.
It's also a good book.
Oh, you're learning cooking, huh? That's really good.
He's teaching Maharaj.
You're teaching cooking? He's teaching cooking or teaching philosophy?
Both.
A little bit of both. Yeah.
He wants to cook for you.
Really?
One of these days, yeah.
Okay. Very good. And we may have to bring you out to ISV, because I was sitting with all our kids the other morning at breakfast, and I was asking them how, who knows how to cook. They all know how to do bhajan now. They can do madanga, kartals, and harmonium. But I said, how many of you know how to cook? And they said, I can make toast. I know how to make cereal. Only one of them knew how to make rice. Kartavya, what kind of cooking are you doing? Shabjis? Japati?
Rice?
Dal? Khichdi? Sandesh?
Paneer?
Paneer?
He's going to make for you the paneer.
You're making paneer?
Best recipe.
Wow.
Like paneer
mangi. Oh, and you were going to say something, and then I kind of cut you off. What were you going to say?
No, I'm saying he likes to make paneer mangi.
I see. Very good. Well, that's a talent that will make you appreciated wherever you go in the world. It's true. Cooks and musicians.
Yep.
You know, so musicians is like, people just like, yeah, send them over here, give them a business class seat, and get them out here, you know, as soon as possible, because they bring up the atmosphere. And cooks also, everyone will want to have a cook. So those are good things to learn. Cooking is such an important devotional art. It's amazing, you know, when Prabhupada came, there were so many other gurus that came that talked about impersonalism and everything. Prabhupada is so personal, one of the ways that he's very personal was he cooked for everybody. He cooked for all the devotees. It really won their hearts. He would cook. And it was just amazing to see a guru that cooks also. And that he does everything. And he's also cooking for everybody. And when somebody cooks for you, it's really nice. You just, you know, you have to sell yourself to that person. That your heart just goes out, right? So Prabhupada said this is a kitchen religion. Did you know that? Or a kitchen religion. It's always the most important part of the house, is the kitchen. Because living entities like to eat. Stop eating, they get all morose. Hare Krishna. Loka, how's everything?
Everything is going great.
I see you every Friday. I always look forward to see your program here broadcasting out. And you've been doing some reading also, some special readings online, the Bhagavatam.
And then I went up to India.
You just got back.
Yeah, just a week just back.
1 week?
Yeah.
Yes,
I'm good.
Everything's good?
Yeah, it's such a good time there.
And were you able to, she came to the Govardhana Ashram, right, like 2 days before I left.
Yeah.
Did they take okay care of her?
Yes, yes, I used to take prasadam there. It was so nice, just like you said. Prasadam was perfect. It was very nice. And then I attended the Virgin Prabhu and Satyananda Maharaj's holy name.
Is it over?
Yeah, they're doing the Govardhana retreat now. So they had a 3-day break and then they do the second retreat.
Oh, goodness.
Yeah.
Wow. Raja Bihari was there?
Yes. Rukmini Mataji was there. Raja Bihari.
And are we going to have any Nimai sightings this weekend?
Nimai has gone to Alachua for the whole
Oh, well, I get to see him, right?
No, because they're just Thanksgiving, they have a kirtan program there, right? 24-hour kirtan.
Yeah.
So
I see.
All the youth are assembled there. And
so he's attracted to the 24-hour kirtan, eh?
Yeah, all the devotee kids are all going
here. It's nice.
It's like a yearly tradition now.
Yeah.
They do it every year. He came straight from college and went off with his friends next day.
There it is. You have kirtan and nice prasadam and some association. And it's very attractive.
Yeah.
Loka, you're good?
Yes, sir.
You're lined up for the December marathon?
Yes.
Nice.
Yeah. We've been trying to do more door-to-door.
Has that been working well?
Yeah. They're increasing that. So the next few months we'll focus on door-to-door.
Nice. What about store-to-store?
We need to do that.
Yeah.
That's our week.
It's just like door-to-door, only everybody's home. And they have money. Absolutely.
Yeah.
I like it much better than door to door. Except for sets, if you're selling sets of Bhagavatams, door to door is really good. But we were in Naperville. Somebody there was a real estate agent and went through his records and found out where all the rich Indians lived. So we selectively went through the neighborhoods. We just pull up in a neighborhood right at somebody's door. Think, why are they coming to our house? Because you're going to buy a Bhagavatam set. But that was a good method. I think we sold about 15 sets of Bhagavatam.
Yeah, that was a big number.
In 1 day?
2 days.
Wow. 2 days, yeah.
Sold
that number. We have a real estate agent too, Ashwini Agarwal.
Yeah, that is good.
Insider trading.
Yeah.
You like door-to-door? It's interesting seeing how people live too, right? According to the modes of nature, knocked on fire. Then you open up and you just see how people are living in there. Well, can we have a little kirtan?
Thank you.
Natural Marman, Natural Marman, Natural Marman, Natural Marman.